Hi, Keith here. Mark's behind the camera, and today we're painting an old shed using only three colors.
All right, before we get started, I'm going to go over what materials Keith's using today. We have some Daniel Smith tube paints, a Pyrrole red, a new Gamboge yellow, and an ultramarine blue. He's also going to be using three different brushes from Lowell Cornell. We've got two ultra rounds, a number 4, which is the smaller tip, a number 10, that's a little bigger tip, and then also a flora brush, a number 10, that has a unique tip to it. Keith's also using an Arches 300-pound cold-press watercolor paper with a typical blue masking tape border. He's got his enamel butcher tray for mixing paints, works really well. And just a standard mason jar. You can use a cup, whatever you want, or washing the brush and getting your clean washes, for lack of a better term.
I would make sure that it's a transparent container so you can keep an eye on your water. If it gets a little dirty, you can take care of it then. Go rinse it out, get some more water.
Great. And links to all these materials are in the description of the video below. There's affiliate links. If you use them to buy the items, we make a small commission. You don't pay any extra. But feel free to just go pick these up at your local art supply store, too.
Well, I've already sketched out my scene on my 300-pound watercolor paper. I'm about to start mixing paint. Now, the idea of this whole project is to get a more or less full-color painting out of using only three colors. I'm going to begin by mixing a couple colors together, two or three colors together, to get different colors. So I'm going to start with a little blue, a little ultramarine blue, and I'm going to mix it with a little bit of the new gamboge, which is a fairly healthy yellow. As you can see, as I mix this, it's going to be turning a little bit on the greener side, okay? So
you started off with the number 10 Ultra Round brush, right?
Well, I'm just mixing up big plops of color, okay? So I'm going to use a big brush to do that. Another color I'm going to mix together now is the ultramarine blue and the pyrrole red. Just as you can see, I kind of pull these colors off. What's going to happen is I'm going to pull different colors off to different angles and create different colors. So this is kind of a violet color, but not exactly. It's a little grayer violet, let's put it that way. And I'm going to use this violet color. I'm going to add a tiny bit of yellow to this. And I should pretty much end up with a brown that I can use to paint my building, some of the color in my building. So I've got two or three colors set up that I'm ready to use. So I'm going to go ahead and start. I'm going to grab a smaller brush. It's not a very big picture, so I think I'll just use a little smaller one to wet my paper very quickly. Now I'm only going to wet one side of this building because that's all I want. So the paint goes only where the water is. So I'm going to do this side real quick. I'm going to take the ultramarine blue just straight. I'm just going to run a little of this color. This will kind of be the shadow side of this building. So I'm adding the blue to create my shadow. And then I'm going to take a little bit of that brownish color I just created. I'm going to bleed some of that into this blue. Hopefully when I move things around, I'm not off camera.
Yeah, no, you're fine.
Okay. All right. So, I like to give old buildings that kind of blue and brown. It kind of gives it that old feeling of old barn wood. So, I'm going to now move across the top of the building, or the front of the building. Now, this little building, I don't know, it might be a little difficult to see, but I've put a little tin roof on it, and it has a little tin front porch on it, too. Right now, I'm just doing the very front of the little shed. So, again, I'm going to use the blue, probably not as dark this time. I'm just going to lightly fill in that one little section. And then again, not too dark. I don't want it too dark because I want this side to stay the darker side. I'm just going to add a little of that color, that brown again, and just let it blend into the blue. And it'll kind of merge together and create a kind of a multi-color value to it. Gives it the look of different planks of wood. So. Trust me, we got to go a little farther before I show the effect.
Real quick.
Yeah.
So where are you picturing your light source is coming from?
More or less this way. Okay. It'll be coming towards the front of the building. The side, that's why the sides are a little bit on the darker side. And you'll notice when I do the underside of this porch here, that it's going to be fairly dark under the porch. So in fact, that's about where I'm going to start right now. I'm just going to lightly put some color in. I'm going to leave the beams to the roof, to the, you know, to the porch. I'm going to leave them white, and I'm just going to come in. I'm just going to start adding color.
Now, is there any particular reason you started with the shady side of the building, the shaded side underneath the porch, versus, say, the grass or the sky in this one?
Well, for the benefit of you guys watching and watching me paint, I think it's kind of good. What I'm trying to do is get the focal point of this painting started. So you gotta, you know, see where I'm going with this thing. So I think it's a little better for me to start there. And then the other part of it is when we start doing the background, the foreground, it's gonna be pretty wet and slurpy. So I figure let's get all the detail done kind of first, right off the bat, get it out of the way. We've got sky to do, we've got trees in the background. So as you can see, I just keep adding color. It's still wet, right? So I'm still just kind of bleeding color into these. And then I'm pulling, like on the porch here, I'm pulling the color down. And I try to vary the color a little bit. So I'm using the blues. I'm using the, you know, the brown that I created. And even grabbing the brown, I'm grabbing a little more red so I can create like different browns here. So as you can see, this is a little bit redder. And I am going to kind of bleed it down to the bottom of the porch now. If you'll notice, I also left a little bit of white there for the corner of the building, just so I can keep an eye on it, make sure I'm not bleeding into the other side here. All right, so I've got it down to the porch, more or less. Porch, I'm just going to do a very dark. I'm going to take a little bit of the blue and the red again, create a fairly dark grayish blue. I'm just going to kind of do my, kind of lay out my porch a little bit. Nice miss. Okay. All right, now I'm going to kind of stop there, let it dry up. meanwhile, I can do other things while this was kind of drying up. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do a little old tin roof. So I like them nice and rusty. So there's going to be quite a bit of red to it. Too much. Okay. So now, this time, you'll note that I'm not going to really wet it until after I put a little of the paint down. So I'm applying this dry brush, it's called. And that is, basically, I'm applying paint to dry paper as opposed to wetting it. So as you can see, I've got some of the color on. I'm sorry. I tend to wipe the excess paint off on my pants. Old bad habit. I recommend having a paper towel. It's probably a lot better for your clothes.
Or maybe putting like a bath towel on your lap.
Yeah, whatever. It's just another thing I've got to have then. But
we don't take Keith out to dinner after painting.
No, exactly. They don't take me out at all. They put me back in the closet. Get back in there. All right, so I've kind of started kind of a nice rusty red for the roof. And as you can see, I'm adding a little bit of water now to what I've painted. And the reason is I can create fairly hard edges by letting the paint run, by dropping the paint, the water in. It helps the paint run to the edges like a little tidal wave, and it kind of sticks to the edges, and you get these very sharp, very distinct paint lines. And I use that for boards, everything. You'll see. Anyway, I'm going to do the front now, and you'll notice I like to start at the top. And then I'll kind of drag some of this color down, staying in the direction of the tin. So, that was dry brush. Now I'm going to apply just a little bit of water. I'm just going to bleed some of it down. And I'm going to let that also set up. On this side, I also will add a little bit of water just to create a little sharp edges here and there. It's very fun and effective way of getting some very clean lines into a watercolor. All right, at this point, I've kind of got my building there so you can see it. I'm going to create some background to this. So I'm going to start with the sky. So I'm going to grab my bigger brush again. And I'm going to be real careful. Normally I would let this dry completely, but I think I'll just be careful and not hit my building. Okay? So I'm going to grab just plain ultramarine blue for my sky. And you can see it's very good to have a large tray, because then you can really spread out and create a lot of different colors. So I put a little blue in there so you can kind of see what I'm doing. I'm wetting the paper. Now this 300 pound requires a little more paint than the 140. It's just more absorbent, more ridges and bumps in the paper. So you do have to add a little more paint. But I love the texture. So I got a little bit of a cloudy thing going, a little darker blue over here. I might even add a tiny bit of red to my ultramarine blue. Create even a little bit of a purple cast to the sky here and there, too. Just to make it a little less uniform. So, kind of even... Oh, sorry. It actually gives you a kind of a stormy, a little bit of a stormy sky. So, we'll go with that.
Just to remind everybody again, Keith started with only three colors. So, by picking the right colors, you can mix a large variety of colors versus spending a fortune on every shade of purple paint, every shade of browns. You can buy those colors if there's a specific one you like to use a lot and it becomes difficult to mix. But with the right base colors, you can get quite a range in your painting.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. I haven't done this in the past, and I just started doing this recently with my classes, and I've had a ball with this. This is just fun, you know, because you experiment. You can try other yellows. You can try other reds and blues. You know, some yellows and greens, you know, some yellows and blues don't work well together. So it's you trying to find what's going to be best for your painting. But it's the three primary colors, the red, the yellow, and the blue. So I just chose those three because these are three that I've worked with, and I enjoy it. I enjoy the colors that I get from it. All right, so at this point, I've got the sky in. I'm trying to keep working. So as long as I'm not touching anything else, I can keep painting. So I'm going to do a little foreground now while I'm waiting for the top to dry. So I'm gonna do a kind of a heavy yellow, a little bit of the blue in it, because I'm just trying to get the lighter value colors that I'm gonna be using for the foreground grasses and weeds and things like that. So, now you can wet it. I tend not to. What I'm attempting to do is just kind of create a little bit of texture on the ground, so I don't necessarily wet it. That being said, you want to be careful that you don't, you know, overdo the amount of paint you're plopping on there. So as you can see, now here's a little technique that I love. On a dry, especially 300 pound, it's got a lot of texture to the paper. What you can do is you take your brush, I don't know who I'm pointing to at this point, you can take your brush, don't use the tip, but actually use the whole side of the brush and drag it along the paper with a little bit of paint. And you'll notice that it kind of hits some of it, misses other parts, and you get these wonderful textures. So then I can fill that with other colors, other things in a little bit. I also have a post here that might be a little hard to see that will be going in there, an old fence post. But I'm just gonna, now I'm gonna take, I use that kind of grayish yellow. Now I'm gonna kind of fill it in with a little more of the brighter yellow. So I'm coming around this post here. As you can see, using that texture, working the paint not too dry or not too wet, I can actually create this ground texture. Then a lot of times what I'll do is, once again, I'll go in and I'll have a little fun. I'll add a little water to that. And what happens is, once again, the paint will go to the edge and you get a kind of a nice rough texture to the paint. So, but this is just my base coat. We're going to be adding more color on top of this in a little bit. So, where am I at? I'm afraid I'm going to have to stop. So, let's take a break and then we'll come back and continue. Hi, we're back. I have let the paint dry on my completely on my painting. The reason we do that is that's what sets the paint. So if you want your, especially with Arches watercolor paper, you can put many layers of color, glaze after glaze, layer after layer of paint. As long as each time you let the paint dry, it stays. If you, you know, try to work something while it's still wet, it's going to get up and move on you. So, like I said, the best way to set your, if you like something, you stop, you let it dry, and you're good. So, I'm good. I'm ready to continue. I'm going to throw in some of the background value, a little darker stuff, just so the building will pop out a little bit better, and you can see a little bit better what's going on, I hope. So, let's give it a try. I'm going to start with the blue, and I am going to apply it. This is kind of where my vegetation behind this old shed is going to be. So I'm going to apply. Am I still?
Yeah, you're good. I'm just.
Okay, good. I start moving around. I'm going to apply some of the ultramarine blue kind of behind the building a little bit. So create a some value for the vegetation. I'm going to drop the green kind of right, or the yellow, I'm sorry, kind of right into the blue. I'm wondering if I need a bigger brush. Yeah, I'm going to use the larger brush again, just so I can get a lot of color. I'm trying to shoot for a lot of color here, so I'm also going to mix up some green, and let's see what we can do here. So, as you can see, I'm not too concerned about, you know, individual trees. We want the feeling of just a bunch of stuff behind the building here. I'm just gonna keep pulling color up. And I don't really have any, the branches will come last. That'll be like the dark, moody branches from the back here. So let me just work on this a little bit, pull up some vegetation. I want it to get right to the building there. I don't want to kill all those cool purples and violets that I have in the sky, so I don't want to drag this up too high. Topping these things off a little bit. I'm going to come on this side and do the same.
While Keith's working, I'd like to invite you guys to, you know, give this video a thumbs up if you like it and you want to see more paintings and tutorials like this. Subscribe to the channel. We've got a complete winter birch tree scene. The video series is spread over 3 videos.
Yep.
If you follow it in that kind of stage, it gives you natural breaking points to let your paint dry and set up and take a minute to look at it with some fresh set of eyes. Don't try to go through all 3 videos in one setting. There'll be some drawing tutorials coming as well. There's a few on the channel. So just subscribe, maybe hit the notification bell, check out Keith's website, he's got prints for sale. Any little thing helps.
Yeah, we're committed, we're going to be doing this for a while, so definitely. I've now added a little bit of red to create a little bit of brownish cast in there, and you know, it's kind of funny. Trees don't have to be green. But what they do have to have is value. And that's part of what's going on in the background here. I'm trying to create some very dark darks to push the this little building out front a little bit. So, all right. So now I'm going to go to a smaller brush so I can manipulate a little bit more. As you can see, I don't know if you can see my tray, it's getting interesting. All right.
And if you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. We do read the comments, and we will try to answer any questions or concerns that you may have.
And we like challenges, too. You want to see us try something? I'm more than willing to give it a try.
As long as it's not a red cardinal.
Yeah, no red cardinals. I only have one rule in life. No, it's kind of fun to find out what people are working on, what they like doing, what they want to do. So, okay, so right now, I'm going to start pulling some of this color down. Onto the ground a little bit. So I'm actually using my colors here and just grabbing and pulling. As you can see, the texture really is what kind of makes these paintings. So anyway, one of the things I didn't do over here, which I'm going to do in a little bit here, is there's a chunk of the roof that's, you know, chunk of the background there that we need to see, so in the building. So I'm going to go ahead and put that in right now. Okay. Always kind of keep an eye on where you're putting your hand. I've come up with some interesting paw prints in my paintings over the years. Okay. All right, so we're starting to get there now. Now I'm dropping little bits of water in there. This kind of creates blooms. That's where you're pushing water or picking the paint up and kind of pushing it around. I think the other fun thing about doing these like very dark backgrounds is when you drop one color into another color, you're kind of pushing color into color. That's what I'm going to do now is I'm going to add some reds. And then I'll be pushing the yellow over top of that to kind of get a little browner colors, little, not quite so stark of red. Okay. Yeehaw. I gotta get the yard going here in front too. But I think what we're going to do, and this is just, like I said, this is kind of just the setup. For the trees that we are putting in. So this is color, but not necessarily, we haven't defined anything yet. So we'll get to it. Right now I'm just kind of dropping color. And experiment. Can't say how much time it takes to kind of get comfortable with your brush and with your paints. So, you know, try. Do 2-3 of them. Don't be afraid to Don't give up either. Finish it all the way through, even if it looks funny. That sounds weird, but it's called working through the ugly. And so many people give up a little too early, and it's a shame, you know, when actually if they just pressed a little bit farther, they might have gotten what they were looking for. So I'm gonna hang on a second. I'm gonna add a little vegetation at the top here. That's what I wanted up here. I had one tall tree behind the building here. All right. Now, right now I'm just kind of scrubbing in a little more detail up at the top here, so it isn't so big chunks, but kind of making little smaller bits of leaves and stuff. So, all right. Okay, I'm going to take a break here, and I'm going to dry what I have, and then I'll go back in and start structuring this. So, be back in a sec. All right, I'm back. I have my dried watercolor. I'm ready to begin again. I'm going to start adding some detail to the background, a little more value. Then we're going to do a little foreground. And then we'll start detailing out the house. So let me start with the background. What I'm going to do is add some tree limbs, some branches, try to give it a little more detail again. I'm going to mix the blue, the ultramarine blue, with the red and get a very dark violet. So lots of paint, lots of value, okay? So I'm going to come in here. As you can see, it is, you can get a fairly dark color. And the purple doesn't have to be, like, bright purple. So it's probably a little more red to blue ratio. So I'm just going to start getting some branches in, breaking this up a little bit. That will be adding more color, but I'm just trying to set things up a little bit. And as you can see, I'm working dry. If it were wet, it would just be blown away, basically. So, all right, a little more dark color. And I am trying to kind of keep my background trees a little farther away. So that's why the trunks are small. These aren't short trees, these are actually tall trees, pretty far away. So, got that going. A little more. I'm going to do a little more over here. Then I'm going to start filling in with vegetation, kind of getting a little more value going. Ooh, this is going to be decided to put a tree a little closer. So as you can see, it's definitely, the pieces are a lot bigger than what's going on over here. So these guys are a little bit closer over here too. So this side, the trees are a little closer.
You said that.
All right. I'm going to do just a bit more again. Okay, so now I got some branches in. I'm going to go ahead and supply basically the leaves to the trees. They don't have to, you're not doing individual leaves, but trees have clumps of branches that are leaves. It's not just, a big clump. It's not a ball of leaves. It's usually a bunch of little clumps, and it helps give you a little more realistic look to it. If you're breaking your trees up a little bit. Alright. I'm burying the color a little bit. So I get some dark leaves here and there. As you can see, I've put darker color in front of the first set of colors I put in for the trees. I'm now putting darker in because they're closer. And I'm getting... And I want them to... Well, what it does is it pushes the other background up back a little bit, so you get a little depth to your trees and stuff, to your forest, let's put it that way. Or your woods, or whatever you're working on. Alright, so I gotta hold this up for myself. Alright, so... And what I do is, I work for a little while, I'll fill it in, we're gonna let it dry, and then we'll go back in and we'll do a little more. So watercolors is layering. It's a lot of layering, figuring out what you want, and going from there. Now, I don't know if you notice, I've left a lot of... This is going to be foreground shrubbery. So that's going to be a little bit of different textures. But right now, I think we're getting there. So, all right. Come to the other side. Oh, that's not working. I put a little too much red into what I was doing and made a mess. So I'm just going to find another clump of green and move on. All right. So if you notice when I do my the leaves, if you look, you're just kind of dancing the paint across the paper so that you're not hitting it all, so that it looks like it's kind of broken up. And then again, this tree. So like I said, I'm doing this dry right now. But occasionally I will take a little bit of water and kind of loosen it up a little bit. Give it that watercolor feel. Adding a little yellow to brighten some of these areas. Okay. All right, let's take a break. Let's take a break on the trees here. Let's go to the foreground. I'm going to create some tall grass So there's a bit of a yard back here. I'm also going to be introducing some tall grasses to the front. And I'm also going to kind of set up my ground over there. I kind of let it get away from me. So I'm just going to wet that up a little bit so I can play with that. But, okay, so... Well, I'm going to do a little foreground now. I'm going to put some tall grasses in the front. I've got an old fence post that's sticking up. I'm going to put that in now. So I'm going to start with the fence post. Just going to add a little ultramarine blue, my favorite. And give it a little value. Then I'm going to mix up a little bit of the brownish color, reddish brown. And we, you know, it doesn't have to be one color. Definitely not, actually. So I've added a little bit of that brownish tint to it. And we're going to let that get to drying so I can put some work into that. So for the grass, I am going to put some tall grasses in the front here. What I like to do is kind of give myself guidelines of where I want the grass to go. So I've given myself three large chunks of grass, because grass doesn't all grow straight and perfect all the way across. It folds, it falls over. So it's very nice to, you know, have an idea of, you know, the direction where it's going. So I am going to use, I'm not sure what I'm going to use. I'm going to use my smaller brush. No, I'm going to use my larger brush. I was confused. I'm going to mix up. I want to mix up some ground cover color. So I'm going to use the yellow and the red. A little more to the yellow side than the red. And I'm just going to throw down two or three large swipes of color. I'm doing it dry right now. Okay, now take my smaller brush and I'm gonna start using the paint that's kind of on the paper there. I'm gonna start lifting that paint and pulling it and creating some fine lines of grass that's kind of blowing. And the trick is to do this so that it isn't all going in one direction. That's the most important part of this, is to kind of break it up so it goes in a couple different ways, but not so that it's like a 180, okay? Grass really doesn't do that unless I think you're in the desert. It kind of rolls and folds and it goes, falls down in different directions, but, you know, not in a fan, okay? So have it kind of go in one way. All right, so you're going to notice that as I work, I'm going to add some other colors in front. I can do it while it's wet. As you can see, I'm creating a negative grass. That sounds weird, but along the areas here, along the front here, what I'm doing is I'm putting a little darker color into the lighter yellow. And then as you can see, I change the direction. And then I might grab a little more paint, make a little more paint. Sometimes the bigger areas, you really gotta, you know, create enough paint so that you're not constantly going back and having to create more. So, all right. I think I'll grab a big glob this time. grab just a little bit of that blue to kind of tone it down a little bit. There. All right. So, I'm going to grab my brush. I've got my slightly richer color. And I go over the top again. As you can see, it's all kind of blowing this way, but it ain't all blowing straight, you know. It's funny, people get into patterns. When I do this, the classes that I do, it's kind of fun because I'll look and they'll have, you know, just perfect grass all, you know, marching in a row, you know, and it's like people tend to want to do patterns. So you got to kind of break yourself of that. And that's what I do is I grab my paper and I really try to mix my movements here. So and so I've got some little bit of longer stuff here. Now I haven't done much around the front of the house there. I'll probably shorten up the grass as I get closer to the house there, but but this gives you that nice feeling of long, you know, unkempt, uncut front yard. How's that? So, like I said, it doesn't all have to be line work. If you'll watch, I don't know if you're keeping an eye on me, what I do is I go and I kind of wet it and fill it in with a little color. I knock it down so it isn't all just little tiny fine lines. We need value or it gets weird. Thousands of tiny little thin lines. So you need color, value. All right. So I've got the foreground in. I'm going to leave this light. I kind of like that. Gives it that watercolory feeling. All right. Now, I'm going to get a little this brown up in here, because like I said, I kind of lost my ground. I want to be able to set the building on the ground. So I came back in, I had a little foreground there, or a little background there, a little background. There we go. I feel a little better. Yeah, cool. All right, now, as I get closer to the building, I don't want it to be just, you know, full field all the way up. So what happens is I'm going to get a little bit away from where I was working before. Now I'm going to still do line work, breaking it up as I go. And it's kind of fun. What you want to do is, if you can, if it's dry, you want to anchor your hand, and then once you kind of know how hard to press, then you can just kind of keep going, and you've got like an anchor point. You're not like sitting here doing this. You can control the brush a lot easier if you kind of anchor your hand down. Now, sometimes you're not going to be able to do that because things are wet and stuff, but trust me, you'll enjoy the fact that you're resting your hand so you can get a good strokes, basically. Again, negative space. I've colored behind the lighter color, and I've created like another whole layer of grasses. And then finally, towards this end over here, I'm not going to really do a whole lot of fine line work. I'm just going to kind of maybe, you know, push a little of the grass up over the building. And I'm kind of happy with that. All right, so that foreground really kind of filled in a lot of this painting now. I am going to finish up the little post over here real quick. Now our light is kind of coming this way. Fine lines. And I got to show you another brush. I'm sorry. I haven't used it. I kind of forgot I had it. It's called the Flora brush. I don't know why. Maybe they make flowers with it. I would like to think I know everything. All right. This brush is very interesting because it has a very wide, almost like a flat, wide base, and then comes up to a very fine point. I always call these cat's tongues, but maybe there is a slight difference. I don't know, but it's a wonderful brush because you can hold a whole lot of paint, a whole lot of water, and get it down to a very fine tip. So a lot of times you can spend a lot of time without reaching for paint. It's all in there for you. And this particular brush was a gift, and now I fully endorse this thing because it's amazing what a fine tip it has. So, por exemple, I can start doing my line work. And it's just absolutely the finest thing I've worked with. And I do a lot of fine work. If you'll notice, my brushes are definitely geared towards more of a detail kind of artist. Okay. So, like I said, as you can see, this brush, I can get some very nice line work done. And yet, if I need paint or color, it's there for me too. I can, you know, kind of tip it towards an edge or a side, and I can use it in many different ways, almost like a flat too. Alright, so I am going to run over here very quickly. I'm going to finish up my post.
Just another reminder, all the brushes, the paints, are in the description below with links so you can purchase one if you'd like to try it or take it to your local store. I'm sure they can get one for you if they don't have any stock.
Cool. Alright, so I'm going to start creating a little bit of color, a little bit of depth, a little bit of shadow. I'm going to finish up this building now real quick, I hope. So does Mark. I want lunch.
This video has turned into, I think it's pretty close to like an hour and a half long.
We're gonna have to split it.
I'm thinking about it. We'll see if it's a natural, like, halfway break point.
Well, you're way past that.
Well, I mean, like, one of the breaks where we already took, where I reset, if one makes sense to.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, I'm sorry.
This will be continued next week.
Right. Sorry about that.
Or maybe it'll be the test. Will people sit through the whole thing?
Yeah. But I think you're right. That's an awful long time. So I'm creating the shadows under the roof. I am going to create the shadow of the tin roof. And if you'll notice, it doesn't have to be super sharp or super clean because it's an old building. We want it to be kind of crusty, so to speak.
Will you paint a cat on top?
Yeah, that's next. That'll be next week.
Cat on the hot pan?
Yeah. Been there. If you ever worked on a tin roof. All right, so I'm just gonna kind of wash this down a little bit, very lightly. I'm gonna come in, I'm gonna add a little more of the blue again, the ultramarine blue, just to get a little more shadow. Yeah. All right. So, unfortunately, I think I have to stop and kind of let this dry. Right after I finish this bit of flooring here. Okay. Now, I'm also going to see how I create the shadows on the post there. Because the roof kind of does extend out a little bit past the post. All right. So, I'm going to stop here. I'm going to dry this out. I'm going to finish up the building. Maybe play with the background a little bit more. We'll be more or less finished. Of course, usually what I do is I'll take a day or two off. I'll look at it and say, oh, okay, what else needs to get done? So it's a nice break because you've been working on it. It's kind of nice to get away from it for a day. So let's go ahead and let me dry this. When I'm back, we'll just touch it up, finish it up, and call it a day. All right, let's finish up this building. First thing I'm going to do is add a little more value to the roof now. Roofs. I'm not here for English.
I want to know where you buy a shed with a porch.
Yeah, tin shed, tin roof shed. Down south. Uh-huh. Everything's down south. All right. I got everything. So as you can see, I like to leave a little of the lighter color in there. And it just gives you more, a little more value, a little more interest. Over here, this is the darker side. So I'm just going to hit it fairly heavy, but you'll notice I left some light in there. Just gives a little character. All right, now I'm also gonna add a little bit more, maybe a little grayer brown back here on the side. Over here, I'm just adding a little more color just to make it a little more corrugated, a little more action. All right. I'm now going to come over. I'm going to do a little bit of shadowing. A little more shadowing. Because I feel it just is. Now that I've put more color on the painting from when I started this building, you just get the feeling it needs a little more value now. So I'm just going to add very quickly. I can amuse myself for hours. So. Okay. Got a little more value. Okay, well, let's dry it up real quick. I'm gonna hit a little bit more of the scenery in the back. I've been kind of looking at it and thinking, let's add a little more vegetation. I'm using the very dark blue-green, basically. Very dark. So like I said, I'm kind of putting this in front of the other background colors. It like I said, it kind of gives it a more depth. It isn't like one thin layer of trees. It is now, you know, a bit of a forest or a bit of a... Okay. If you'll notice, I'm not doing very large blobs of color anymore. I'm kind of breaking it down into a little smaller stuff. Kind of dried up. This is pretty close. Basically, I'm going to grab that very fine tipped flora brush and I'm going to do the line work in the building. Put a couple windows in it. Let's see. Are we dry enough? No. Surprise. Not quite. I gotta wait. How about over here? Let's try this. Oh, yeah. Very good. So I'm just, I like to put a few big cracks in there. With a damp brush, I usually will go in and just kind of soften those lines a little bit so it isn't quite so harsh. Okay. If you're going to touch to check your paint, don't rub, tap, okay? Alright, so...
You know what that fence post is missing?
Some Barbara water? Barbara Waters? Yeah.
Some barbed wire and a no trespassing sign.
Oh, all are welcome to my crusty shed. I'm sitting around waiting. I'm sorry. I should, probably let it dry, but... We're close, and so again, I'm mixing the red and the blue to get a fairly deep, such a deep purple that looks almost black.
Would you suggest people use black paint?
No. I'm not a fan of black. I believe that you can create prettier blacks, prettier grays, you know, than using black. Black tends to be terribly flat. There are different blacks, but I haven't met one yet that I really am fond of. So I'll use a red-green mixture to create a nice, very dark black. But very intense, very shiny. A lot of times, too, I'll use indigo and brown, like a burnt sienna. I'll do that, too. I just like creating blacks that aren't flat in color. All my students know I'm not a fan of black. I'm not a fan of Payne's grays. I like kind of making my own color when it comes to black and black and grays. All right, so getting there. My old shed don't have no windows or nothing in it. I'm just gonna make little dark surfaces. Last thing I will do, but I'm not sure I can do it quite yet, is the fine lines for the old barn wood. Yeah, I guess we're getting it. As you can see, I like to put hard lines in, then I kind of like to blend them a little bit, just to soften them up. Not all everywhere, but it's what kind of gives a watercolor kind of a nice soft feel to it. Like I said, I think we're getting fairly close here. Get a little edge here. Okay. A few lines can do quite a bit. A little bit of shadow on this back. Right there. Just going to kind of dirty up near the base here. And I think we're pretty close now. The only other thing I wanted to include was maybe kind of just a rough driveway here. So just a little blue and a little stone or whatever. And just let it kind of bleed right out and off the page. And like I said, I'll go back, I'll touch it up, I'll play with it, but I think we're pretty close. Get a pretty good idea of what you can do with just three colors. Get a pretty good range of color in this thing. Oh, barbed wire. Should I?
It's you.
Yeah, real quick.
That post just looks kind of lonely.
I know. I'm just, it's not getting a lot of barbed wire. It's not going anywhere either. It's kind of broke down barbed wire. Just let it go. All right. Thanks for watching. Give this video a like. Be sure to subscribe to my channel. And don't forget to check out my website, rkmcguire.com.
And don't forget, all the links to the materials Keith used today are in the description below. If you use the links, we get a small commission as a thank you. But don't feel obligated. You won't pay any more, but support your local art store too.
Yes. Bye.